In this video, I'll be adding a riser block to increase my vintage Grizzly 14-inch bandsaw's cutting capacity from 6 inches to 12 inches. However, this is no simple riser block install. I bought the saw at an auction, and it was missing some of the pieces of the riser block kit, so I had to fabricate some from scratch. Those of you who have this saw, how do you like it? Let me know in the comments section. When I say the saw is missing pieces of the riser block kit, I mean that it only came with the riser block. Not included were the longer connecting bolt for the column, the block's alignment pins, the extended blade guard, nor the extended blade guide post. I'll start off by cleaning about 30 years worth of dust. Next, the old blade comes off. It won't be usable with this saw any longer once the riser block is installed. Here I'm removing the bolt that connects the upper and lower portions of the saw at the column. The riser block kit should have come with an extended bolt for passing through the block at this point. The column and riser block are aligned with pins in the corners. These happen to be 6mm round pins, which is slightly smaller than a quarter inch in diameter. If you have a quarter inch round stock, you can make it work with a little sanding or machining. I found 6mm round online and used that instead. I cut the pencil length with the hacksaw. Then I slightly chamfered the edges so they fit into the holes easier. Since the column bolt is too short to work with the riser block, I extend it with a 3/4 inch coupling and a 3/4 inch by 10 thread per inch threaded rod. With the threaded rod cut the length, all that's left to do is use it to fasten down the upper portion of the bandsaw. Before continuing, check that the wheels are in alignment. You don't want the wheels to be pointing in separate directions, otherwise the saw won't function well. With the riser block installed, I took the time to scrape the rust off the bed. Using a trick from Matthias Wandel, I applied a water-based polyurethane to the bed and wiped it clean to provide some protection and also to make the bed a bit slicker. Now that the saw has a 12-inch cutting capacity, the old blade guide is far too short to guide cuts down by the bed of the saw. I needed to fabricate a new guide post. To make matters complicated, the original post is 21mm hex stock, which isn't commonly available in the US. However, 13/16 hex, which is about 20.64mm, is close, and we can adjust for the slight undersize of the post. First, I put the new hex stock in where the post goes to measure the needed length and marked it. Then I cut this with the hacksaw. Removing the blade guide from the post, I double check the diameter of the tenon for the guide, which is 21mm, same as the dimension of the hex stock. The tenon length is 24mm, or just under 1 inch. You don't need fancy milling equipment to turn hex stock round. Just start knocking the corners off with a file and slowly work your way to round, checking the fit with the blade guide as you go. As I noted before, the new 13/16 inch hex stock is slightly too small, so the clamp for the guide post needs to be shimmed out. One way to do this is to drill for some rivets on one facet of the hex. This will give 3 points of contact on the hex shank, which is enough to keep it stable. While I had the bandsaw apart, I thought it was prudent to replace the tires on the wheels. These are a little difficult to install since they want to pull off the tire, but a couple clamps as third, fourth, and fifth hands make things easier. The plastic filler piece on the column is no longer long enough to cover both cavities in the upper and lower castings. The easiest way I could think to remedy this is to cut the plastic piece in half. The top section screws into the existing holes. The bottom piece needs new holes drilled and tapped into the casting to hold it in place. With the riser block, the old plastic blade guard on the left side of the saw is too short to span the gap. It's possible to cut it in half and extend it with some sheet metal, but mine was too broken to try, so I fabricated one out of sheet metal. The dimensions on the guard aren't super critical. It just needs to cover the blade and provide enough clearance so that the blade won't snag on it. I bent the cutout piece by clamping it to my workbench and persuading it with a mallet. This is much, much easier with a sheet metal brake, but I don't have one. I may remake this piece in the future if I get one, but it'll suffice for now. Also, I didn't do this first, but I recommend deburring the edges before you bend so that you don't slice up your hands. With the guard bent, I put it against the bandsaw to mark for mounting holes. I just eyeballed these and then drilled through the guard. Then I put the guard back against the saw, used the drill to mark the holes, and completed drilling through the covers. I then tapped for number 10 24 machine screws. With the holes tapped, I checked the fit of the guard on the saw. Then I degreased the guard and coated it with black spray paint. To make the guard easier to take off and put back on, I decided to make keyhole slots. This is done by first drilling a hole slightly oversized for the head of the number 10 machine screws. Then the two holes are connected with a slot. Now, the guard can be slipped on through the larger holes and slid into the smaller slots, then tightened down. With everything done, all that's left to do is install a new blade, tension it up, and get to cutting. The saw cuts through this 6-inch thick butternut log with little problem, as you can see. I have more upgrades in store for this saw, so stay tuned for more. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe.